sir. Yes, sir.
Jello Beats, holla at me.
Come on, Jermaine, what's going on?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Welcome to another edition of Sports Shop 27. I'm your host, Jermaine. And to my far right, we have a special guest. In the middle, we have KJ, our co-host. But today's special guest, we have former Clemson and the Citadel quarterback, and now Florida A&M head football coach, Willie R. Simmons. What's good,
Willie?
What's up,
Willie?
What's going on, coach? How you doing, man?
What's going on, fellas? Hey, that's a great intro, man. Bought back some memories.
Hey, man, I appreciate it, man. Class of 99 in the house, baby. What's good?
Yeah, all day. You know it.
Yeah, man. You know it. So for the people that don't know you, let them know about yourself and a little bit about your background, man, and where you're from.
Yeah, no doubt, man. From right down here in God's country, North Florida, right outside Tallahassee. Grew up 20 minutes away from the place I call home now, and grew up in a big family. You know, still did Sundays every dinner every Sunday at Big Mama's house, at Grandma's house, and we still do that to this day. You know, my mom was the oldest of nine in her family. My dad was the youngest boy of 10 in his family. So came from a big family, started playing sports at a young age. And obviously, you know, that led to a scholarship opportunity to Clemson University, where I met KJ and, you know, came in the same class. And, Tommy Bowles' first recruiting class, Rick Stock still, you know, signed all of us and got us there to Clemson and, you know, had a great run, man. We went to four bowl games during my time there and made a lot of great friends and guys I still call brothers to this day. And from that, you know, went on to get into the coaching world. You know, started out as a high school coach in Tallahassee and was fortunate enough to get an opportunity back at Clemson as a grad assistant. And then from there, just my career kind of took off. You know, went to Middle Tennessee to work for Coach Stock at Middle Tennessee State. Left there, went to Alcorn State as a coordinator for 3 years. Then got my first opportunity as a head football coach at Prairie View A&M. I was there for 3 years out in the north of Houston.
Texas.
Yeah. Yes, sir, out in Texas. Then I was called home, you know, to be the head coach here at Florida A&M. So, been a great three-year run. You know, my wife and I both grew up here. My wife's a fourth-generation Rattler, you know, and got her undergrad from FAMU, master's from FAMU, and she's a semester away from getting her doctorate from FAMU. And, oldest son is about to graduate with his undergraduate degree this summer. And, we got six beautiful kids and just, you know, great to be home, great to be around family, and great to be able to lead a program like FAMU, one that has meant so much to us as a family personally. But from an athletic standpoint, to be able to bring this program back to national prominence is something that means that's near and dear to my heart as well.
That's right. Great, man. Great. So talk about the times in your development stages when you started out. Was football the only sport that you participated in, or was other sports that you played?
Yeah, so growing up, man, we were three sport, man. Football, straight from football to basketball, straight from basketball to baseball, and right back to football. So I did that probably from the age of 8 all the way through my junior year of high school. And once I got to become a sophomore in high school, I kind of figured that football was going to be my bell cow. It was going to be my thing that got me into school. And so, but I knew as a quarterback, I needed to be able to put on some pounds and some muscle. And basketball kept me from doing that, running up and down that court. So I only played halfway through my junior year and then played all my senior year, but I still played baseball. You know, so football and baseball were really my two passions growing up. And depending on who you talk to, they say, you know, baseball was probably my best sport, but I still played football. Our good friend Charles Harper, who KJ knows, unfortunately, was taken away from us some years back. But Charles was the baseball player. You know, he was the big time baseball player that played football. I was the football player who played some baseball too. But yeah, we tried to play as many sports as we could down here in Quincy because, again, not a lot of things to get into. If you're not playing ball or going to school, you're probably going to be getting in trouble. So stay busy with sports, and that kept me out the streets.
Great. Go ahead, KJ.
Yeah, what position you were playing in baseball, man?
Man, all over, man. Started out playing infield, you know, second base, shortstop. And then once I got to high school, transitioned to the outfield. So, you know, played outfield. We were a really good baseball team, you know, very talented. All black team, and that was rare to see an all black team that was really, really good in baseball. But we had a pitcher who ended up playing for the White Sox organization. Had a second baseman who ended up playing some minor league ball for a while. Again, Charles could have gone and played college baseball at a number of places, but he chose to play football. And so we had a really, really good baseball team. But I played all over. But looking back on it, when the scouts came down and saw the way I threw the baseball, it was very similar to how I threw a football. KJ can tell you, you know, quick release, short stroke. If I played catcher, I probably would have had a chance to, you know, maybe, you know, play beyond high school because my throwing motion most resembled a catcher, you know, quick release, get the ball out of my hands quick. But, you know, I wasn't trying to be squatted down for 9 innings.
That was my position in high school too. Yeah, so I know what you're saying.
Oh, yeah. But if I had to rewind and do it over again, I would have got behind the plate.
There you go. You would have got paid a lot of money to squat like that too. I tell you that for real. But so you played baseball, man. I know you probably played on some all-star teams. You probably pitched a little bit, played outfield. Let's talk about the hooping skills, man. What position you played on the basketball court?
So what's funny about that, man, you know, it's crazy because you would think that being here in Florida that it's football territory. For some reason, growing up in Quincy, everybody wanted to be a basketball player. You know, okay. We all thought we'd be in the NBA, even though we've never really had an NBA player in Quincy ever, I don't believe. But, you know, we just always thought basketball was – I was supposed to be 6'5". You know, I got cheated. I was going to be 6'5", you know. Yeah. But once I got to high school, I thought I was a two-guard, you know. And I know, of course, listeners now don't even know what that means. Like, what's a two-guard? What's a shooting guard? Because there's no positions in the NBA now. But back then, you had a point guard who distributed the ball. You had a shooting guard who shot threes and got score points. You had a small forward who was a slasher, power forward who rebounded, and a center who was the big guy. So exactly. I always envisioned myself as a shooting guard because, you know, as KJ can tell you, I had a little sweet jumper.
Y'all ball together?
Yeah, we hooped out there fight, man. You know, we used to go out there fight and hoop a little bit. But
in that hot gym,
you already know. But my coach would always put me at point guard because naturally being a quarterback had good vision. So, but I hated point guard. Like I didn't handle the ball as well as other guys. I could shoot. I wanted to be on the wing shooting.
Come off the pick and shoot. Yeah, man. Shoot. He
wanted
to spot shoot.
That was me. Catch and shoot. Yeah, that's it. He was my idol. You know, I was a Reggie Miller fan growing up. Hey, straight Reggie Miller. You know, cross race and everything.
I tell you, me dog. But go ahead. Yeah. I'm listening. But you went from basketball and now you're going into football season again. You know, that's how that transition happened. You got to put the weights down a little bit and then pick them back up again. Go out there and run a little bit more. Talk about that transition going from basketball straight to football again, and then making that decision to stick with football, and then talk about your recruiting process after that.
Yeah, it really was, you know, football to basketball, and then basketball to baseball. Like that was the way the seasons, you know, went. So we play football, you know, we go to the playoffs. The basketball season would start as the playoffs began, so I'd always miss the first couple of games, and then we go out on the basketball court. Well, if anybody has played both, totally different conditioning. You know, from being a football player and then getting out there running up and down that basketball court. So took you a few games to get your legs under you, get in basketball shape, you know, and then we did that. And then it went straight to baseball. So as soon as basketball playoffs rolled around, baseball season was starting. So I would go play baseball without having hit a ball in over probably 9 months, go into the baseball diamond, play baseball. And then when the summer rolled around, then we get back in football mode. you know. So I spent my summers really going to football camps more than anything else, because again, once I hit my sophomore year, I figured that football is going to be, you know, where I make my money. So I'm not going to go to baseball camps and play post ball. I'm not going to go play these AAU basketball, because that's not what's going to get me to the next level. Let me go to football camp at Florida State, at Georgia Tech, at Auburn, at some of these places, because that's where I'm getting my letters. All my letters are in football. I don't have a basketball letter. I don't have a letter from a baseball team or a scout. Football is where my letters were coming from. So I devoted most of my downtime, which was the summers, to football. But man, it was definitely football from September to basically November. Basketball from November to February, baseball from February to April, and then and that cycle just started all over.
So I was gonna say, you played it the Florida Georgia All-Star game?
I didn't play in the Florida Georgia game. I was selected to play in the North South game, chose to not play in it, you know. Once I signed, I just, you know, didn't want to risk any type of injury, you know, in my mind, just like KJ and all the guys that came in 99, we were in Coach Bowden's first class. So our mindset was, we're coming in to play right away. You know, we're going to take somebody's job. We got to come in ready. So I didn't play in the All-Star game. You know, I went to Clemson that June and tried to get ready to be, you know, to be a starter as a freshman. Didn't happen, but that's why I made the decision to opt out of the All-Star games and try to prepare myself for, you know, for freshman enrollment.
Yeah, but you graduated early from high school too, right?
Yeah, like, well, I didn't graduate from high school. I actually came to college with a lot of college credits. So I was dual enrolled. I was dual enrolled in high school. So I took junior college classes while I was in high school. So I left high school with my associate's degree. So when I got to Clemson, I was basically a second semester sophomore in the classroom. So that's why I was able to graduate from college in 3 years, you know, my undergraduate degree.
Cool. So you go into your visits, you go in your locker, your mailbox, you get letters from schools.
Yeah.
What colleges got stamps on those letters, bro? And out of all the colleges, Florida State was one of the biggest schools in that era, winning, going to the national championship back to back. Talk about why Clemson and not Florida State or Florida A&M at the time in 1999.
I can sum it up in three words. Rick, stop, steal.
Wow.
Man.
Hey, I'll tell you, man, he was the master recruiter, man. He got all consistent. Of us up there, man. And just, it, like KJ said, man, just consistent. You know, it didn't matter. You know, he didn't panic. Even when I was that close to going to Georgia Tech. Like, up until the last minute, I thought I was going to Georgia Tech. And he just stayed consistent. Just, you know, and he really – I pattern my recruiting now off of what he did back then. So everybody else was recruiting me, you know, Georgia Tech, Florida State, Miami, Syracuse, you know, all these other schools were spending time recruiting Willie Simmons. Rick Stockstill spent his time recruiting Phyllis Simmons, my mom. Yeah. And that's how, because I was a mama's boy. So he won.
He
went to the heart. He got to my heartstring, which was my mother. So when I said I was going to Clemson, she had the biggest smile on her face ever, because that's what she always felt, the closeness, because she had a personal relationship with Rick Stockstill. And that relationship, extended to the time she passed away. And that was something that was very important to me, that I went somewhere where she felt comfortable with the people that I was going to be around. So I've taken that motto with me. You know, everywhere I've been, that, you know, I'm gonna let other people recruit the student athlete. I'm gonna recruit them parents, particularly mom, because most of us are mama's boys. So I'm gonna make sure mama feels good with me. And if she does, I got a much better chance of getting the kid than somebody who's just recruiting a young man.
That's right, man. Cool.
So you ended up at Clemson. Rick Stockstill's there. He's offensive coordinator, you know, the wide receiver or quarterback's coach. You're coming in, Woodrow Dancer's the quarterback at the time. Talk about being in that position and how the X's and O's and being important on the sideline, facilitate plays to your teammate is important, and learning the system.
Yeah, so, you know, we got there. Brandon Streeter was actually the quarterback. And so he was a senior. Woody was a rising junior or sophomore, I can't believe, one or the other. And then I was a true freshman. And so Streeter started the year off. Rich Rodriguez was our offensive coordinator. And so Rich was, I mean, tough. Like, Rich was a tough, tough, tough guy to play for. I love him to death, loved his coaching methods, but he was tough to play for. So it was a revolving door. I mean, Streeter goes in, he makes a mistake in practice, Rich yanks him out, puts Woody in. Woody goes in, makes a mistake in practice, he yanks him out.
You gotta be perfect, baby.
You gotta be perfect to the tee. And so he kept rolling us in there, preparing us, but, you know, Streeter started the season. He ended up getting injured, and then Woody came in. And it's so crazy how just, you know, the Lord works and how things work out. Because in my mind, I was going to play as a freshman. I had, you know, that really circled that fourth game of the season. That was really all of us. KJ probably remember that freshman meeting we had up in Malden, where all of us threatened to leave and we weren't starting by our fourth game. So, whole freshman class. It was like 18 of us sitting in one room in a little small. We leaving and we ain't starting by fourth game. Yeah. So, yeah, fourth game is North Carolina. And Streeter goes in, breaks his collarbone.
Okay.
Woody goes in, we go 3-and-out. Come back in the next series, go 3-and-out. So now the third series, Coach Bowden comes to me and says, hey, I'm going to give Woody one more series. If he doesn't get it going, I'm going with you. So I'm ready. This is it. Like, this is my time. If I get in this game, it's over. They're not going to see, no quarterback's going to see this field again for like 3 years. Woody Bansler, tightrope on third and probably 12, ran a quarterback draw and tightrope 40 yards down the sideline and ran it in, like a 50-some yard quarterback draw. It was like one of the most amazing plays I've ever seen. And obviously the rest is history. You know, Woody went on to be one of the best quarterbacks in the country. And, you know, but it was just wild like that. And literally, if he hadn't converted that third down, I'm probably going to play as a true freshman. And so, you know, but he goes in, he does well. And we had a great relationship, man. All the quarterbacks had a great relationship. So my role at the time was to be the backup. So as a backup, you know, I wanted to win. So I'm going to help Woody. You know, I'm going to look and see what the other team is doing. And he'd come off the sideline. Oftentimes, he'd come to me first. Hey, Ray, what did you see? And I'd say, hey, they're spinning the covers this way. You know, look, throw it to this guy. Then he'd go get on the phone with, you know, Coach Coach Rodriguez, and then later on Coach O'Kane, who became our coordinator. So we had a great relationship. You know, I was the first guy to celebrate Woody scored a touchdown. I'm the first one to go celebrate with him. You know, that's just a bond that we had, the closeness that we had at the position. And you know, it really went a long way in just establishing our lifelong bond as brothers, because again, we know we played a position that only one guy can play. You know, and Woody waited his turn, he got in and did his thing. I waited my turn. You know, fortunately for me, it didn't work out the way that I envisioned. You know, I didn't finish my career there at Clemson. Started 8 games and had a decent career and, you know, transferred out my last year because I wanted to go somewhere where I was guaranteed to start. But, you know, I have no regrets about my decision to go to Clemson. Met phenomenal people, learned a lot, and it's really shaped and molded me to be the man that I am today.
Great, man. Great. So did you start in any bowl games while you were at Clemson?
I didn't start in any. I played in a couple. Played in the Gator Bowl down in Jacksonville, you know, versus Michael Vick of Virginia Tech. Played up in Boise I forgot the name of the bowl, but humanitarian bowl, the bowl that none of us wanted to go to. We threatened the boycott. We threatened the boycott. Like we weren't going to go. And I tell you what, man, KJ can tell you. Like the most fun trip ever. Like we all talked about going back to Boise, the vacation that, like after we got done, it was so fun. But played in that game, and then my last game was down in Orlando in the Tangerine Bowl. We don't talk about that one very much because we got our butts handed to us by Texas Tech and Cliff Kingsbury. So but I was able to play in that game a little bit at the end, and then that was my last game, you know, with the Tigers. But you know, went to 4 bowl games, played in 3. And, you know, again, man, great memories, great just, you know, watching those guys play, you know, watching Rod Gardner and Derek Hamilton and, you know, Brian Mance, our classmate, you know, just a lot of great guys, man, that really went on and did some amazing things. You know, Keith Adams, you know, ACC Defensive Player of the Year, you know, so it was a great time, man. We had a bunch of fun.
Yes, sir. So talk about leaving Clemson and going to the Citadel, that transition. It's a whole different, another culture. You're going from Anderson or Clemson, South Carolina, to Charleston, South Carolina, military school. So talk about that in the offense and the system that you're put in now as a passing quarterback going into, I guess you say, wing T offense or I formation.
Yeah, so, you know, left Clemson, initially was transferring to FAMU. You know, we had always said coming out of high school that if we, any of us, all the guys from the area, if we left where we were going, we were coming back to FAMU. Like, it was just, it wasn't even a discussion. We were coming home. So transferred to FAMU. That year, FAMU was in the process of trying to become the first HBCU to make the transition to, back then, 1A football, which would not be FBS football. So they were granted provisional 1A status for a year in 2003. So because of that, we had to fall under FBS transfer rules, Division 1A transfer rules, which at the time, you weren't allowed to transfer from 1A to 1A and be immediately eligible to play like it is today. Nor were you allowed to be, I was a graduate. So the next year, that's when they passed the graduate rule that said if you graduate, you can transfer and play right away. That rule didn't exist in 2003. So got here, went through practice for a couple of weeks. We were deemed ineligible. Me and I think 13 other transfers were all deemed ineligible to play. So with about 2 weeks before the season started, I was scrambling, you know, panicking about where I'm going to play. Fortunately, you know, Ellis Johnson, the head coach of the Citadel, had coached at Clemson. Les Heron, the defensive coordinator at the Citadel, had coached at Clemson. Great friend of Rick Stockstill. So, hey, calm down. So, got connected with those guys and, you know, went to the Citadel. And, you know, it's a military school, but because I was a grad student, I didn't have to do the military stuff. You know, I got to go to class just like this and, you know, regular clothes. Didn't have to do any of the PT and any of those military obligations. So it was a great experience, man. I mean, had a great year. We had our first non-losing season in 10 years there. I was first team all conference, you know, met some great guys. You know, Scooter Johnson is like a brother to me, you know, Bud Pugh, you know, great friend of mine, you know, Kevin Olecki, you know, all those guys that I met, Sean Grant, you know, Juice, you know, you name it. It was the same bond that I had with the guys at Clemson. And even though we didn't play in front of 80,000, you know, we didn't get to run down the hill. We didn't get to go to bowl games. We just love the fact that we got to play football. You know, we had a great time playing the game, won some big games, games that they hadn't won in a long time, made history. You know, we were one of only two teams in the Southern Conference to beat App State, Georgia Southern, and Furman all in the same year. Only one other team had done that was Marshall. You know, Marshall did it back when Brandon Moss and Chad Pennington and those guys were there. We were the only other team to do that, was beat the quote-unquote Big Three. And we did that my senior year, man. So had a great time, had a lot of fun. And like I said, man, I have zero regrets about my decision to go to Clemson, to ultimately transfer from Clemson, and then to attend the Citadel because, again, all both those places really shaped and molded me into who I am. And I met some phenomenal people, you know, who are still brothers to this day. And I live life with no regrets.
There you go, man. That's good to hear, bro, for real. So right now, you leave in the Citadel. You go into the real world. Did you go play any professional sports or anything, like any arena league or overseas or anything like that?
Played one season of Arena 2 football, you know. So went up to the Sioux City, Iowa, and played for about $250 a week. And went up there and played for the Sioux City Bandits. And crazy thing, and again, it's like we talk about funny how life turns and how things go. We had a guy on the team, right, running back, phenomenal football player. I mean, as good as anybody that played with at Clemson. I'm like, man, I played with Rod Gardner, who's a first-round draft pick. I played with Woody Dantzler. I played with Derek Hamilton. I mean, I played with some big-time football players. And this dude is just as good as all these guys. And I'm like, he's sitting here making $250 with me. Like, if he can't go to the league, I know I'm not going. So I wasn't even going to try. That guy was Fred Jackson. Fred Jackson ended up leaving there, going play NFL Europe. They ended up getting in camp with the Buffalo Bills and ended up having a 2-year career in the pros, you know, being a big-time NFL running back. I played with Fred. Like, that's my dude. And he and his twin brother, Patrick, you know what I mean? So it was crazy to sit there and watch him But he was kind of my rude awakening, like, okay, no, like, you're not going to sit here and chase this NFL dream because you're nowhere near as good as Fred Jackson. If this dude ain't playing pro ball, you're not playing pro ball either. So yeah. I wasn't going to chase it. Man. I played one season, and then, you know, grace be to God, man, on my way home from Iowa, got a call from one of my good friends, asked me if I wanted to be a high school coach at one of the prominent high schools there in Tallahassee. I jumped at the opportunity, you know, to kind of quote unquote buy time until I figured out what I was gonna do with my life. But the moment I stepped on that field, I fell in love with coaching. Like I knew right then that was my calling, and I hadn't looked back since.
That's what's up, man.
That's great, man. So this is your fifth season at Florida A&M?
Going into my fourth. Going into my fourth.
You're going to your fourth? Cool. And right now, how many players have actually left Florida A&M under your tender and made it to the NFL?
So Calvin Astley is a young man who just – we only played two seasons. So played my first season in 18, played in 19. We opted out of last season. So going into my fourth year as head coach, but I've only coached two football seasons. And so Calvin Astley, a young man who came to us, transferred to us, offensive lineman, he – decided to declare early as a sophomore for the NFL draft. And he actually went undrafted, but he signed an undrafted free agent deal with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. You know, so he's with the Buccaneers. But I did coach players out of Prairie View who were playing professional football. Kadarius Hodge, a young man who was a wide receiver that I signed, that I coached there. You know, he's playing. He was with the Browns. I think he just signed on. He may still be with the Browns. I can't remember exactly if he signed on or not. Quentin Bell, a young man I signed out of California who came to us as a wide receiver, transitioned to defensive end. He just won a Super Bowl ring with the Tampa Bay Bucks. Terrence Singleton was a cornerback who played for us, who played for the Bills for a little bit. Anthony Stubbs was a linebacker with the Cleveland Browns. And so we've had our fair share of guys who've had their opportunities to play pro ball. And obviously here at FAM, we're building a program where more guys will get those opportunities. And we feel like we have a team this year with at least four or five guys who have legitimate shots to either get drafted or sign on as priority free agents.
Man, you're doing a good job. Man, that's what's up.
So did you ever think growing up that you'd be the head coach at one of your favorite college football teams?
Growing up, I never thought I'd coach, period. It was never on my radar. You know, the funny thing is, and I tell people all the time, you know, we keep talking about Coach Stockstill, you know, again, he's a friend to all of us, even to this day. He would always say, while I was there, he said, Willie, you're a smart guy. If you can do anything other than coach, do it. And I never talked about coaching. I never said I wanted to be a coach, but for whatever reason, he would always just say that to me, like just out of the blue, randomly, you know, Willie, you're a smart guy. You can do something other than coach, do it. And I always thought I was in business. So in my mind, I was going to be a sports agent. Go out and, you know, be Jerry Maguire and sign all these big contracts, represent these pro athletes. That was what I was going to do. And who gave me my first full-time job? Rick Stockstill. So same guy who tells me not to coach gives me my first full-time job. But growing up, man, I never really thought about coaching. It wasn't something that was in my purview. I just thought I was going to be in business somewhere. But again, man, it's funny how the Lord works. And like I said, when I got the opportunity to coach, which really was just something to do, I took that job because I didn't have anything else planned at the time. But like I said, the moment I stepped on that field with those young men, BJ Daniels, who was a sophomore at the time there, who went on to play at South Florida and play in the NFL, I coached him as a sophomore. And man, I tell you, I fell in love with developing young men. And that's the joy I get every day, is to be able to wake up and really have a profound impact on the lives of 18 to 23-year-olds and see those guys realize their lifelong dreams.
That's right, man.
Cool. So right now I have a clip that I want to share with everybody. It's basically showing you guys in 2020, you know, getting a new facility at Florida A&M, changing the culture. So let's check that out real quick, okay? All right.
This generation likes things. You know, they like to see facilities. It's a facilities arm race all across college football. And so for us to continue to attract the quality of student athlete that we need to be successful here at Florida A&M, you know, we need our facilities to match our academic reputation. We need our facilities to match our play on the field so that we can continue to attract quality student athletes. And so this locker room renovation is critical for our ongoing success. I think it will definitely position FAMU to be a major power, not only in the black college landscape, but FCS football as a whole. And I think it's something that really gives us the ability to attract student athletes to FAMU that maybe we haven't been able to in the past.
So let's talk about that, Willie. Let's talk about the facilities and how you believe changing the culture and amenities for the students can motivate a better, bigger program.
Yeah, no doubt. Well, when you first said video, I got scared. I thought KJ was about to pull out something from 1990. Hey, I'm sitting there crossing my fingers like, what KJ don't pull out on his blank?
Oh, I wouldn't do you like that.
Nah.
Well, my wife listening to me. What was that? But yeah, again, being at a place where, you know, with so much attention being brought to HBCUs now, with young men, you know, actually considering going to HBCUs, you know, over PWIs and FBS programs, you know, we definitely need to be able to have facilities that attract these young men. We need to be able to show them the type of resources that make them feel that they can achieve their goals by coming to an HBCU. You know, I don't think there's ever been a question as to whether you can come get a great education or whether you can have a great personal experience. I think most people know that at HBCUs, as black men and women, we're going to elevate. You know, we're going to be around other brilliant people that look like us and really be able to be around the best and brightest. But when it comes to athletics, you know, we've kind of put the facilities race on the back burner in many cases. And so in today's climate, you know, that's what we've really been making this push to, hey, we need facilities that match our academic reputation. You know, that's we've right. been the number one public HBCU for most of my life. You know, we need our facilities to match the type of recruitment that we've had for, you know, non-student athletes. You know, we just got a young man, 16-year-old young man, to choose FAMU over $1 million worth of scholarship opportunities from Ivy League schools and, you know, other prominent institutions around the United States because he wants to just go to school at FAMU. And so we need our athletic facilities to match that, you know. So we started the Rattler Athletic Fund with our new athletics director. And in the 18 months that he's been here, you know, we've been able to raise close to $1 million, you know, for renovations. Like the locker room renovation that you just saw, weight room renovations, brand new floor, brand new roof, brand new weights in the weight room. Our training room is being completely renovated, a brand new roof on the field house. All doors, locks, the carpet, the whole nine, graphics in the building. And so if you came to FAMU when I first got there and walked through the field house, and then you come now and walk through the field house, it doesn't even look the same. You won't even recognize it. But that's a testament to the commitment from our administration, led by our president, Dr. Larry Robinson, but driven home by our new vice president and director of intercollegiate athletics, Courtney Gaucher. And it's a great time to be a Rattler, man. I'm telling you, I'm proud of what we've done. The work isn't done, obviously, you know, but we've come a mighty long way from where we started. And now it gives me the chance to really go out and recruit, you know, these 4- and 5-star kids and see if they want to, you know, take their chances at an HBCU, see if they can accomplish their goals, which they can.
Oh, yeah, most definitely.
Yes, sir. Most definitely. Yep.
Yeah.
So you guys had a spring practice this year. And, you know, I have some highlights. I want to share that with the viewers as well. And we'll talk about some of your players and then also talk about the conference you guys are in. And then we'll talk about some of the competition, okay?
The sun is out on a gorgeous Saturday afternoon for Florida A&M football. The Rattlers hosting an open spring practice for fans as Willie Simmons' squad fine-tunes the hard work they've been putting in over the past few weeks in preparation for their first year in a new conference. The the Marching 100 offering some therapeutic sounds to welcome in the 2021 season. And based on what fans got to see on the field Saturday, they should be very excited to see the Rattlers in action this fall when they enter the Southwest Athletic Conference. Both the offense and defense made big plays in an afternoon head coach Willie Simmons said was refreshing to be a part of. Seeing a live-action game from the confines of Bragg Memorial Stadium brought fans some normalcy back into their lives. And that's what today was really all about for everyone involved.
Feels real. Just very exciting to be able to finish the spring. 15 great days. And to be able to have our fans see our last open scrimmage, just a great feeling. I feel like we've grown as a team. You know, obviously, whenever you don't play in 2 years, you got a brand new football team coming in. Guys haven't played together, haven't been on the battlefield together. And it's over 15 practices. It's really about coming together as one, figuring out I knew I did it.
Yeah. So you guys came out with spring practice. You got a new season ahead. Let's talk about the season opener. Who do you guys have?
Man, opened up the season right out the gate. Miami Gardens down at Hard Rock Stadium. Conference game fresh out the gate versus Jackson State. And obviously their new head coach, Coach Deion Prime Sanders. And so it's been a game that's had a lot of hoopla surrounding it already. And that will only grow as we get closer to September 5th. And again, you got two powerhouse programs going toe-to-toe with a larger-than-life figure as a head football coach at one place, you know, really doing a great job of recruiting and selling that program. You know, but we're looking forward to the challenge. You know, our team hasn't played in over a year and a half, and so we're going to be chomping at the bits to really get out there and play against someone else because we've been kind of banging up on each other for the last 18 months.
Yeah, that's cool.
You want to highlight any key players that's on your team this year to watch out for?
Yeah, man, we got some really.
You see your boy Troy say go GS.
He's showing out. I got some for him. I'm gonna call him when we get off. I'm gonna be on this week when he on too.
That's up for you.
Okay.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah. I'm gonna be on.
What you're saying?
Yeah, but you know, some really really good players returning. You know, we returned all of our skilled players from 2019, with the exception of our quarterback. You know, obviously Ryan Stanley left his mark on family's program, broke all the passing records at the university, but all his major targets are back. You know, Xavier Smith is coming off of 1,000 yards receiving season, first-team All-American, top five in most statistical categories in FCS only as a sophomore. You know, so he returns with the vengeance. You know, his running buddy, Chad Hunter, you know, is back for his senior year. You know, Chad was the guy for us at wide receiver before he battled some injuries, but he's back 100% healthy, and I'm really looking forward to seeing him. Azende Ray is another guy that's in that what we call our rack boys, you know, the receiver crew who can play running back and receiver. You know, he's been a threat for us even in the return game. And then our backfield, you know, we have some horses in the backfield there by Bishop Bonnet, you know, three-year starter, a little lightning in the bottle guy, but Terrell Jennings, Jalen McLeod, you know, Eddie Tillman. So a packed stable. And then defensively, it all starts with Marquise Bell. You know, Marquise is a former Under Armour All-American out of high school. You know, four-star kid from out of Bridgeton, you know, New Jersey. 6'3", 205 pounds, you know, can cover, can run, and will knock you silly. You know, and him, the biggest thing for him is making sure that he stays in the game because he, you know, sometimes likes to leave the crown of that helmet a little bit. So, you know, he's an enforcer, you know, but – you know, we've really done a great job of recruiting and getting some quality depth up front, you know, that we can roll guys in there and really keep pressure on the quarterback. But we're excited about the talent that we've accumulated over these 3 years. You know, we've had top 10 recruiting classes every year that we've been here. Number one recruiting class in 2020 and the number three recruiting class in 2021. So, again, talented roster, a lot of speed, a lot of explosiveness, a lot of athleticism, getting stronger and bigger. And so I really feel like we have a team that can compete for a championship in year one. Well, year one in the SWAC, year three for us, but year one in the SWAC. And obviously that starts September 5th, right out the gate versus Jackson State.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. So, yes, sir.
You a family man and a coach. Like, how do you balance that out? You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, it's a full-time job on both ends. You know, again, six beautiful children. And so you have to make sure you devote time to them. You know, the worst thing in the world is to be a dad and a father figure for 120 guys, but neglect the ones that you have at home. And so it's about one of them opening the door right now.
Nice segue.
Yeah, it's about it's about prioritizing, obviously, and making time for what's important. And so, right. You know, every morning I try to make sure I get up and help the wife get them together and get them to school. You know, I take them to school most mornings, and then coming home in the afternoons, you know, make sure that we have dinner together, then sit at the table, you know, talk about our days, you know, go around the table. You know, hey, you know, champ, tell me about your day. What was the best part of your day? Shiloh, you know, what did you learn today? You know, because they're both young kids, but they're so vibrant, they're so observant, and they just soak up so much information. You don't want to miss anything, you know. So just spending that quality time with them. You know, they come to all the games, you know, they're on the field in the end zone. Champ liable to run out there on the field during the game, you know. So don't be surprised if you see, you know, a four-year-old come running out on the field right before we score a big touchdown. But you know, again, just being a guy that understands the importance of family. That's one of our seven F's. We have seven F's in our program. All start with letter F, and family is one of those F's. And right. So devote enough time to being a dad, being a husband. And then, you know, there's enough time. I mean, people always talk about not being enough hours in the day. There are enough hours in the day if you're devoting it the right way. You know, I don't have an outside life. That's the good thing about me. I'm a homebody. So when I leave work, I come home. Like, I don't have a hobby. I don't go and, you know, stop by a restaurant or stop by the bar or go, you know, to the pool hall or go play golf or fish. I don't have those hobbies. And so I'm either at work, you know, grinding away, trying to build a program, or typically I'm home, you know, with my family. And then when we do leave, we leave as a family together. So it's been a blessing for me, you know, that I'm not much of an outside person. I like to stay in, and that's why KJ them, you know, went out a bunch of nights without me in college.
Yeah. That's how you represent, man. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah. So is there anybody you'd like to shout out on the show, Willie, man? We don't want to take too much of your time. We know you're a busy man. You know, don't want to cut into your personal time with your family. You know, where can the people find you at on social media? Also, where can they get those tickets to Follow the Fam, you Rattlers?
And, right, man. Let them know. You want to come support, baby, for real.
No doubt. Well, first off, you know, obviously you can follow me on all social media platforms except TikTok. I haven't gotten to TikTok yet, but you know, Instagram, you know, Snapchat, and Twitter. It's HC, like head coach, at HC Willie Simmons. Again, at HC Willie Simmons, and then at Facebook is just Willie R. Simmons. You know, so again, you can find me on those social media platforms. Visit our website, you know, familyathletics.com, and you can go on there. There's a give app to support the program. There's a tab for season tickets. You know, obviously, if you go to the football page, you'll be able to, you know, find, you know, information about our players, about the coaching staff, stats from previous years. You know, so a comprehensive website that allows our users to really get to know these young men, you know. But again, you know, only shout outs. Again, got to shout out, you know, my whole Clemson family, you know, Miss Jill, you know, Fonz, Abe, Coach Batson, you know, the coaching staff, you know, Stock, Coach Burton, you know, Rodriguez. Coach Heron, crazy self, you know, who you know, just kept practice live. But really, all my brothers, man. I mean, again, people don't understand the brotherhood that you share. You know, KJ and I don't talk every day. KJ and I really probably only talked a few times since we left. But the moment we got on the phone last week, it's straight jokes, you know, like we've been together every day, because we remember that brotherhood that we share. We remember those bonds. We remember those moments that, you know, made us who we are. And so, again, just everybody who's ever put on the orange and purple, man, just, you know, so happy to call you guys brothers. You know, got to shout out my family, you know, everybody here supporting us. And then, obviously, you know, my family here at home, man. My wife is holding the fort down. You know, she's in there cooking the tacos, Taco Tuesday. And fix me some tacos. And definitely, man, I saw my two guys, man. My equipment manager, Dakari Calhoun, is on the call. And then obviously Troy Johnson, you know, our other homeboy, who used to be my equipment manager, and you know, always just, you know, great moments, great times, man. Those two guys have really been, you know, true friends to me, true supporters throughout this whole process. And again, man, it's been a wild ride. It's been a great ride. met a lot of phenomenal people. We feel like we're doing some good. And obviously, it's about giving back. You know, we got to keep giving back and keep supporting each other and keep raising up the youth, because they are our future, they are tomorrow, and anything right. we can do to make their lives more enhanced, to give them the opportunities that we didn't get growing up. You know, it's incumbent upon us to do so. So, anybody listening, man, let's dig deep and let's continue to move our younger generation forward.
That's right, man.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah,
man, we appreciate you coming on, Willie. Yes, sir. We thank you a lot. We appreciate your time, and I know you know we'll love to have you back on the show. And as soon as the season starts, and when y'all play Jackson State, we'll have you and Troy on at the same time after y'all play.
Yeah, man, you better get him on before. He'll have a long face when he already got a little gray, little skunk spot right there in his beard. It's gonna be all the way gray.
We got to do something about that.
It's gonna be all the way gray. He's gonna be straight out. Cause
we gotta get him on soon, here, man. We gotta get him on soon.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Well, thank you for tuning in to the Sports Shop 27. I'm your host, Jermaine Colter. Right. In the middle, we got Kevin Johnson, KJ, co-host. And to the far right, we'd like to thank special guests, former Clemson quarterback and the Citadel quarterback, and now head coach of Florida A&M Rattlers, Coach Willie Ray Simmons. Until next time, wear your mask. Don't forget to shop at the Sports Apparel that we have on our page on Facebook. Just click the shop button. We also are on Spotify, Deezer, and YouTube. Follow and subscribe, and we'll see you next time. Until then, wear your mask, be safe. Peace.
It's not how you start. It's not how you start.